Hey everyone, welcome to Church Online. So glad you're with us today. You know, welcome into my office. Not everybody gets to see the pastor's office because you know when you get called into the pastor's office. Anyway, welcome. So glad you're with us today. Listen, we're going to just worship together in a few moments. But just to kind of give you a heads up as to how things work, if this is your very first time today, if you want to talk to someone, there's a live chat room. You can just chat with us, say hi, hello, join in worship with us. In a few moments, we'll gather back here and we'd love to connect with you some more. So let's worship together and let's do that together right now.
Spaces, graces, waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Graces, waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Come out. waiting. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting. Oh, dance like the weight has been lifted. Cause he did it. Yes, he did it. Oh, dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom. Let there be freedom.
The goodness of God.
of the goodness of God.
Your mercy, triumphs over.
to the heart of God. Oh, to the heart of God, the heart of God is all I want.
So we're so glad that you've connected with us today and worshiping together from the comfort of your home or wherever you may be. I'm so glad we can connect with you today. Listen, if you would like to say hi or connect with us, we would love that. We'd love to know what you're up to these days, because it's really important that we stay connected no matter where you are. We love to do that together. Listen, I want to say a huge thank you to all of you who continue to support this ministry week after week. It enables us to go literally all over the world and reach people with the gospel message of Jesus Christ. We've got connections in different places of the world where your support is going to make a difference. And I want to say thank you from the bottom of our hearts. If you're tithing currently, thank you. Keep tithing. And we have something for those of you who would like to go over and above your tithe. It's the offering. And we call that Kingdom Partners, and we're reaching people all around the world and here in our city of Calgary as well. And you can simply pledge an amount that you would love to connect with us as it goes to making an impact and changing the lives of people all around the world. If you want more information about that, go to our website under Kingdom Partners and find out how you can support this ministry. Thank you for your generosity. Thank you for your support. There's simple ways to connect with us today. You can text in your gift, use our app, many ways for you to do that. I want to just say huge thank you from the bottom of our hearts for allowing us to continue this ministry online. We could not do it without you. Thank you so much. Now let's go into the message this morning as Pastor Jess starts a new series.
Good morning, Journey Church. We're starting a new series today called Managing Myself, and I'm really excited about this series because I really want to talk over these next weeks about our own discipleship as Christians. You know, if anything, this year of pandemic has taught us about our discipleship, or at least for me, it has pointed out where my lack thereof is. And I want to talk a little bit over these next couple of weeks about what does it mean to be people who are led by the Spirit, who manage ourselves really well. So the first week, we're going to talk today about our thoughts. Next week, we're going to talk about our emotions. And on the third week, we're going to talk about our words. Our text for this series comes from Romans chapter 12, verse 2, and it says this: "Don't conform any longer to the pattern of the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you'll be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." You know, the thing is, God has a perfect will for us. I love that God has a desired path for all of us to go down, and the Bible tells us that it's good. But the only way we're going to find out, a lot of people will say to me, "Jess, could you help me? I need to find God's will for my life." But the way that we find that is by allowing the Holy Spirit to transform us, to change us. I love this because God is not just interested in sin management for us. He's actually interested in transforming us. But if we're real though. Sometimes when we get into talks like this and we talk about discipleship, it just becomes humanism, right? So we got to pull ourselves up by the bootstraps and work really hard for God to approve of us. And this is not at all what we want to talk about. We want to talk about how the Lord wants to transform us. But there is tension in this. The tension is this: God wants to transform us, but he wants to partner with us to bring transformation to us. And, you know, all of us live on one side of the ditch or another. We have a tendency to be in one side of the ditch or another. Let me give you just an example of this through some stories. I once had somebody say to me, Jess, I couldn't possibly get baptized. And I said, why not? Have you accepted Jesus? Well, yes, I have, but I don't have my life figured out yet, so I couldn't do that. Or people who say to me, I can't come to Jesus until I get my life figured out. And that's one side of the ditch, really. Many of us struggle with a form of humanism. We think that we can do it on our own strength. We'll do it. We'll come to Jesus with all of our stuff figured out. And God never calls us to that. He says, come as you are. You're all mixed up, and I'm going to transform you. On the other side of the ditch, though, there's some of us that would say, we expect God to do everything for us. So I once had a discussion with a young man who said to me, I'm just giving up on Christianity. And I said, why? And he said, because every time I come down to the altar for prayer, I ask God to take away my addiction to pornography. But when I go back home, the pornography sites still work. And of course, this seemed wild to me, but it was this idea that God would do everything and we are just basically robots and don't have to partner with him at all. So there's two sides to this. There's tension in how we manage our own discipleship. And this morning, I want you just for a minute to think about where you sit on that continuum. Some of us are expecting God to do everything and we don't take any initiative. Others of us think that we have to do everything and we're basically humanists with a little bit of Jesus for good luck. And we have to deal with this tension right off the top. You know, the truth is, in some way, all of us need transformation in one way or another. There's none of us that have arrived. None of us can say that all of our life is fully transformed into the likeness of Christ. We know that that won't happen until Jesus comes to get us. And our eschatological hope is that we become like him. But in this life, we're asking God for continued transformation. So some of you might be saying, well, this is going to be just like a practical how-to sermon series. Yes, because we all still need the practical word of God that's going to transform the way that we live. Transformation, though, I want to assert this morning, starts by when we begin thinking about what we think about. Your life is always going in the direction of your strongest thoughts. Let me say that again. Your life is going in the direction of your strongest thoughts. Biologists tell us that the average person thinks between 30,000 and 70,000 thoughts. This was an interesting research point for me. Some said 30,000, others said 70,000. The difference lied in who the author was, a male or a female, and you can decide which way it went. These 70,000 thoughts, though, or 35,000 thoughts, are then turned into emotions and words, and they ultimately become the summation of our lives. Your thoughts are the very first thing, though, that either brings you to a place of victory or defeat. Dr. Caroline Leaf, this time last year, we had her into our ladies' conference, and she's done a lot of research on this. So here's what she said. She said, as we think, we change the physical nature of our brain, and studies have shown this. As we consciously direct our thinking, we can wire out toxic patterns of thinking and replace them with healthy thoughts. When you think, you build thoughts, and these become physical substances in your brain. It would make sense then, if this is true, that we would do a regular inventory on our thinking. The unfortunate part about the way that the world works, though, is that we often don't have time to think about our thinking. This is called, in the psychological world, metacognition, that we would take time to think about our thinking. I can remember one of my mentors saying to me, the most important thing you're going to do as a pastor is think about what you're thinking about. And I would love to tell you that every day I take time to think about what I'm thinking about. But this is a struggle, and I think it's a struggle for all of us. But if we don't think about our thoughts, if we don't allow God to transform our thoughts, a couple of things will happen. I think the first thing is that we'll go where we don't want to go. Let me read this verse to you from James chapter 1, verse 13. It says, when a person is tempted, they shouldn't say, God is tempting me. God can't be tempted by evil, and he doesn't tempt anybody. But each person is tempted by their own evil desires. You see, the thing is, whenever we get trapped in sin, it's because we've allowed a thought to take hold of our hearts. James goes on to say, these desires lead them on and drag them away. When these desires are allowed to remain, they lead to sin. And when sin is allowed to remain and grow, it leads to death. Everything starts with a thought. Your life is going in the direction of your strongest thoughts. This is what the Word of God tells us. So when we don't take an inventory of our thoughts, we go where we don't want to go. We get involved in sin we don't want to be involved in. Second thing is we let things loose that we should contain. When we don't take an inventory of our thoughts, we let things loose that we shouldn't contain, that we should contain. 2 Corinthians 10 verse 5 says, we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought and we make it obedient to Christ. Every thought that we have to ask ourselves this question. Do I need to take this thought captive, or do I feel good about letting this thought loose in my life? Some of us, by the time 9 o'clock comes in the morning, we've let so many thoughts loose in our life that it's no wonder we're feeling like our life is chaotic. I know that a number of years ago, I just had to get very disciplined about what I let loose in my life. Because what you let loose in your life sets up strongholds in your life. And these strongholds then, create havoc and problems in our lives. Paul says that oftentimes we believe lies. We know this from the Word of God, that many of us believe lies about ourselves, about our situation. And the Apostle Paul tells us that these lies, they can be demolished, not by physicality, but by we fight with weapons, spiritual weapons. The weapons we fight with have divine power to demolish strongholds. And so many of us have allowed things to be set loose in our lives, and it's created strongholds, and we need to demolish those with divine weapons, those divine weapons being prayer. I want to assert today that some of us have believed lies for a long time. We've allowed thoughts to run rampant in our lives. Some of you are dealing with shame right now. You've allowed those thoughts to run loose in your mind, like you're not good enough, like God will never see you, like people don't like you. There's others of us that have allowed thoughts of rage and jealousy to run rampant in our lives. And so we look at somebody that comes in with a fancier car than we do, or they've got a bigger house, and we get jealous, and we've allowed those thoughts to run loose in our mind. What we want to do, though, is take all of those thoughts and make them captive and make them obedient to Jesus. The last thing that happens when we don't take an inventory on our thoughts is that we become who we don't want to be. Proverbs tells us, above all else, guard your heart. The word heart here can be substituted for your thoughts, like your inner life. Above all else, guard your inner life, for it is the wellspring of life. You know, if you want to become somebody who's full of life and full of hope, you've got to guard your inner life. You've got to guard your thought life. Okay, so I thought we would just do a little bit of an audit this morning on our thoughts. Just three areas. This is not by any means a full thought audit, but just these three areas. So in the area of worry on one side and peacefulness on the other, where would you say you are? Are you closer to the worried section, or are you allowing the peace of God that transcends all understanding to guard your heart and mind? Are you allowing thoughts that the world is falling to keep you up at night? Or are you allowing the peace of God to flood your heart and mind? Okay, what about in the area of negativity versus positivity? You know, I believe Christians, we should be some of the most positive people on the earth. Why? Because we know in the end, God wins. In the end, we're just dealing with momentary troubles. So let me ask you this. Are you When you get up in the morning, are you leaning towards negativity and cynicism where you can't see beauty anymore? Or are you leaning towards positivity and believing that God's got you? No matter what circumstances you go through, God's in the middle of it. Think of a third area. Are you living with worldly ideas or are you living with eternal ideas? Are you worried about things that are not going to matter 50 years from now? Or are you keeping your mind fixed on eternal things and the legacy that you're going to leave? This is a really important thing for us to think about. How are our thoughts every day? How are we guarding our thoughts so that we can be peaceful, so that we can be people who believe that God has got our best in mind, and so that we can be people that believe and fix our mind on the things that are not of this earth, but are eternal. You see, what you choose to see determines your reality, and you have the power. Now, this is not humanism. You have the power through Jesus to shift your focus, to say, God, I'm going to partner with you now and see things as you see them. So what do we do about our thoughts? If we've taken an inventory now, and I would encourage you in this week to maybe just take a number of moments during your week and say, God, I'm going to think about my thoughts. I'm going to take an inventory of where I am thinking. Okay, so here's what I want you to do this week. I'm going to give you some homework here. This whole series is going to rise and fall on whether we do the work, whether we do the homework and ask God to really do some work in our lives. Listen, I'm believing for a church community that is going to be growing in discipleship. For my own life, I want to grow in discipleship. I want to look more like Jesus this time next year than I do right now. So here's what we're going to do. Number one, we're going to identify the biggest thought stronghold holding you back. So we aren't going to deal with everything. For most of us, that would be overwhelming. But here is the truth. You cannot defeat what you will not define. Some of us have determined just to keep our head in the sand. Like, I know things aren't going very well, but if I just pretend everything's going well, we're not talking about happy, clappy, like, let's just name it and claim it. What we're saying is let's identify where we have a thought stronghold. So maybe your thought stronghold is lust. You need to identify that. Maybe your thought stronghold is materialism. You need to identify that. Greed, jealousy, rage. I don't know what your thought stronghold is. I know that as I was preparing for this, that the Lord just began to put his finger on a number of things in my life that I've had to just confess to God. This is a thought stronghold, God. I haven't taken these thoughts captive. The second thing that you're going to do is you're going to name the truth that will set you free. So I had initially thought about naming a whole bunch of truths. I don't want to do that because I actually want us to do the work in the Word ourselves. I want you to find your biggest thought stronghold. Then I want you to go to the Word of God. You can go online and look up a concordance. There's many, many tools now that are free. But let me just give you an example of them. So maybe your biggest thought stronghold is worry. Maybe you're a worry wart and you worry about everything. You worry about the sky. What you're going to say is, listen, I know that your word, God says, be anxious for nothing. You take care of the lilies, you take care of the sparrows, so you'll take care of me. Right? You're going to name the truth that's going to set you free. What about if you're dealing with shame and you just can't seem to get out of this cycle of shame and like you're no good? You're going to speak over yourself, Romans 8, there is therefore no condemnation to those that are in Christ Jesus. If you're dealing with jealousy, you're going to remember scriptures like Proverbs 14:30 that says, a tranquil heart gives life to the flesh, but envy makes the bones rot. You're going to say things like, God, I'm praying that you would help me to live in tranquility. Okay, so then you're going to name the sin that's going to set you, you're going to name the truth that's going to set you free from that sin you're dealing with, that thought pattern. And then finally, I want to encourage you to write it down and confess it and believe it. There's something good about saying, God, I'm believing that you're making me anxious for nothing. I'm not going to be jealous because I know you want my life to be living a life in tranquility. I'm not going to live in condemnation. There's something really good about speaking that out loud. You know, Philippians 4:8 says, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. This idea that we've got to call ourselves to be intentional about what we think about. If we allow our words to just drift to natural chaos, it's a little bit like chaos theory. You're going to go into chaos. I want to encourage us to become people that partner with God and say, God, I'm going to think about the good things you have for me. I'm going to be intentional about it. And some of you maybe need to just get a little cue card. You can go to the dollar store and get 100 cue cards and write these things down. Something good. Habakkuk 2:2 says, write down the vision so that when you're running, you'll be able to see it. Some of us need to write down the vision for our own thought life, because our life is going in the direction of our strongest thoughts. And I don't know about you, but I want my strongest thoughts to be that God is in control of my life, that I am a disciple of His, that I am a daughter of the Most High God, that I'm the head and not the tail, above and never beneath, that I'm more than a conqueror. And I'm praying in Jesus' name that that would be the thoughts that you would think about as well. Maybe this is all new to you today. Maybe you've just sort of, you love God or you know about God, but you've sort of not taken control of your thought life. Today, I'm just gonna pray with you. I'm gonna pray that God's gonna help us to become people that are intentional about our thinking. Because as we become intentional about our thinking, God can transform our lives. And just as you're in your living room today, I'm just gonna ask that you close your eyes and bow your heads just for a moment, just to take out all distractions. So God, I'm just praying now that as we just bow our heads here and we just take a moment to hear from you, I pray that you'd show us, God, where our strongest thoughts are. Would you show us, God, where we need to give you control? And God, I pray that you'd show us, as we study, God, that you'd show us what the truth is that your word says. And God, I pray that you'd set us free. Help us to take every thought captive. In Jesus' name, amen.
You know, as we just close the service together today, so great to hear a word of encouragement today. And listen, if you want to connect with us further and you need someone to pray with you right here this moment, we would love to do that. That's our pleasure. It's our joy to do that. Connect with us today. You can just ask for a prayer or maybe, you know, lift your hand up today and say, I made that decision. I said yes to Jesus. I would love to connect with someone. We would love to do that today. So simply just connect with us as we engage with you and watch how God comes and transforms your life in the days to come. Listen, if you want more information as to what's happening in the days to come, Easter is just around the corner. We've got some things planned for that weekend. Our Good Friday service. Saturday, we're going to have an event here on the church outside parking lot. And also Easter Sunday morning. So you want more information, check us out. Please sign up for our newsletter. It's very simple. Just go to our website, myjourney.church, and get that newsletter in your inbox each and every week. Thanks for joining us today. We look forward to seeing you next week. Bye for now.